welcome to a new live stream here from the Karchak studio in Germany. Today is a very special occasion because I have to go to this side. We have Luis de Matos in our chat here in our YouTube stream, and he will tell us everything that you want to know and I want to know, and I have a long list of items I would like to speak with him. Recently, I was able to see his newest show called Backstage, Luis de Matos Backstage, from his Studio 33 in Portugal. And if you have not heard of it yet, definitely something to watch out for. We will talk about this in a second. But before we start, here is our intro. Where is it? This one. So, thank you very much for joining us here to our YouTube live stream. If you are here live, please, you can ask us any question in our chat. If not, and you are watching the recording, enjoy it. It will be awesome. Luis is a good friend of mine, and we had some time, oh my God, is it already 2 years ago or so, when we had a great evening. After his Illusionist show in Germany, and here he is. Welcome to our Skype. So, and here is it. Yes, let me see. So that we are all more or less the same. Okay. Hey, how are you doing?
I'm good. Great to see you. Thank you to you and to your technical team and to everybody watching us this end of afternoon. It's a big pleasure to see you again and remember that evening that you just mentioned when we were together in Essen.
That is true. Yeah, it was your first time ever with the Illusionists in Germany. Is that correct?
No, it was the second time. Second time. But the first time we only did Berlin. Some maybe 4 or 5 years ago, and then second time we did more German cities.
Okay, how did this whole Illusionist show start? Were you always be part of it, or were you taken especially here as a host for the European show? How does this work with the Illusionists?
Well, it started back in 2012 when I was first contacted first by Brett Daniels when he was going to Mexico, and it was at the same time as the Essential Magic Conference, the third year of the Essential Magic Conference, and I said no, I'm stuck in Portugal because we are doing this online magic conference. And I remember him saying, hey, but if it is online you can do it from anywhere in the world. I said nah, not really. Because for those of you that have been at the Essential Magic Conference, you remember, for those of you that did not take part in the Essential Magic Conference, this was done in 2010, 11, and 12. And it was, it was done on a time that people didn't even know what the word streaming meant. This was over a decade ago when we started. And 33 of the greatest magicians around the world, they would gather here at Studio 33, and from here we would broadcast to 74 countries, and that was the first online magic convention conference event that ever existed. So anyway, by the end of that year,
that was really a revolution, the first time ever, right? That was really the first ever where you would not go to a convention itself, but watch everything online. So you were far ahead of all of us.
And then on 2013, the producers Simon Painter and Tim Lawson and the director Neil Dorward, they were looking into a second version of the show. So that's when the Illusionists 2.0 started, and they came to Portugal. The funny story was that they for some reason, they were after me, and they talked to Mark Kalin, and Mark Kalin said, oh yeah, but he will never accept to be part of such thing. But Simon decided to contact me anyway, and I put only one condition, is that he would come and visit us. And he did. Came him and the director, Neil Dorward, and they stay a week here with us, and during their stay, they were able to see my one-man show, they were able to see two corporate shows that I've done, and the rest of the day we spent at the studio looking at videos and at illusions and spending time in the library, all of that. Anyway, during the week, we discussed many things for this new The Illusionist show, which was The Illusionist 2.0. And we decided many things, what I was going to do. I was going to do the vanishing the spectator's car, and I was going to do this and do that. All great, very big things in general. And then before the last day, before departing on the following day, they came to see my chaos show. And my chaos show, it's a one-man show. It lasts for almost 2 hours, no intermission, and is only me on stage. I never go out of stage. There's no assistants bringing props or taking props away. Everything is on set, like my all live shows, like my all one-man shows since the beginning since 2002. So at the end of the show, they came to me and they said, forget everything we have discussed during this week. Forget about all this vanishing spectator's car and all this million-dollar mystery illusion, and forget all the big stuff. What we want is from this show. We want the interactive piece. We want the peering fish. We want the newspaper prediction, and we want the Angry Birds routine. I said, okay. So then they find me a nice title, and we start working over mail and Skype and all of that. And then came the time to start to premiere this new show, which with a fantastic cast. I mean, I think it's definitely, I would not doubt in defending it as the best cast, in my opinion, the best cast. And this is a very subjective opinion, of course, but the cast was incredible. And we start in Australia. We did Adelaide, the Sydney Opera House, Brisbane, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, New Zealand. I mean, we traveled the world with this cast, and it was Hugh Eugene, Adam Trent, James Moore, Aaron Crowe, Raymond Crowe, and Dr. Scott Lewis. And yeah, it was amazing. And that's where we started a relationship with The Illusionist 2.0. Then eventually, after the first 3 years, the 2.0 dropped because it was more interesting commercially to not have the 2.0, because 2.0 meant that the show was mainly going to places where the first show has been. But because we are breaking new grounds, it made no sense to have the 2.0. So we became The Illusionists all along. And yes, since then, every year I have been spending 6 months, 6, 7 months on tour with The Illusionists, and then the rest of the time in my own country doing my own shows or TV shows. Actually, when COVID came, when the pandemic hit us, it was contracted 1 year before, 24 weeks nonstop on the year 2020. We did the first week in Prague, and we all came home. And we didn't leave yet.
Oh my God. Are there already plans to start it all over again? Are there at least some?
Yes, there are plans to start it. There is a smaller version of the show. I mean, at least a smaller cast, because usually the illusionists, they have 7 magicians. That are already performing in the United States.
I've seen this with David Williamson being the host. Yes, I saw this.
And there is talk of going back to do 3 weeks in the end of the year in Canada. And already, in that case, I would be involved again. I believe the normal tendency is that everything is going to be back to something close to what it was before the pandemic. I honestly don't believe that that is going to happen, neither fast or instantly, neither soon or instantly. I think it's going to take time and it's going to be a very slow comeback, because what I believe is that first we need to wait for a moment where it's officially safe. That's the first thing. And then you can again play for full capacity on theaters, because that's the only way to make the shows feasible. At least, I mean, every show, each show is made for full capacity. No producer produces a show for 50% of audience. It can be for a 100 seats theater, but it's 100 tickets to be sold. It can be for a 5,000 seats arena, but yet you plan and you work to sell 5,000 seats.
So you have to, yeah.
So first we need that moment. And then there's something which I think is going to be even slower and even harder to achieve, which is that gradually everybody feels again the confidence, the enthusiasm, and the need to go and see live shows. I think people are still afraid, and very rightly so. People are afraid. There is much discussion on vaccines and the obvious need of herd immunity. And today I read an article by Live Nation, and Live Nation said that vaccine certification is going soon to be the new ticket. You cannot go anywhere if you don't have if you have not been vaccinated. So all of that is going to take time. But above all, I think something that works against us is that we came from a time where we all like to go to the movies, we all like to go to see shows, and suddenly and soon is going to be 2 years without doing so. And I know that we never forget how to ride a bicycle, but if we stop going to the gym, it's harder to go back to the gym. So I believe that people will need to get used again to go and see shows, to feel safe, and to enjoy the best form of entertainment, which is live entertainment. The advantage with live entertainment and what you are watching, you know it's unique. You know that what you are watching did not happen before. The fact that it's happening in that moment is sexy, is special, it's unique, and there is an unforgettable connection between performers and audience members. But yeah, we all dream about going back to those times, and I wish those times come back sooner than later.
Yeah, I think, well, recently I did a course for Mosaic, actually, with a friend. And he has his own Mosaic school, and for this two-day course, he organized a COVID test at the beginning of the course. So everybody came in with masks on. Everybody got an official test from a person from the pharmacy. And after everybody was tested negative, they could move over to their place and remove their mask. What was really a nice condition, being on your table, and then later even enjoying the lunch together on a table with strangers where nobody was wearing a mask and enjoyed his food. We were just like, we were hungry, and not for the food, but for this experience. So I hope and guess that this will come back sooner than later. Because we are so hungry for this. I can see it when the restaurants opened up again in Germany, because since November we had a lockdown, and in May or so I think they opened up the restaurants, And they immediately outside, they immediately were like crazy. Not in a stupid way, but really a nice, enjoyable, open-minded way. And I really hope, I was at the FISM Spain, the FISM Europe in Spain this time, where, well, the masks were mandatory inside. Outside, it was nice without. And it worked really well. And I was so pleased to have this feeling back again. So I guess it will come sooner than later, hopefully. Fingers crossed. But I can understand as, yes, exactly. But I can understand as well, for the organizers, it's a nightmare if you are still limited to, let's say, 2/3 of the crowd you can book, and if new conditions appear and you already sold out half of it and you have to cancel everything, that's absolutely a nightmare. Right now I am facing the problem that next month will be Magi Fest in Columbus, Ohio, and until now I don't know how I get there, because so far nobody is allowed to come to America.
Yeah,
so I don't even know if I can go or not. So
yeah,
we will see if it happens for me. Otherwise, and that's why the illusionists so far in America only used American artists, because they don't have the travel restrictions and they could have the smaller team, just Americans performing there. That's the only drawback. However, well, last year it was even worse. We all had the restrictions. I think in Portugal that was even more terrible, that there was no, I think you were not even allowed to be in a crowd outside, right? And you had a fantastic idea with your Studio 33 that you had back then. Do you want to tell something about it?
Sure. So when the pandemic came, I think we all went through the same phases, reacting to this new reality. And first you deny it, then you become angry, then you become frustrated, all of those different phases. And to me, those phases, they last, they all happen like in the span of two, three weeks. And then I read an article on a magazine that I subscribe. And it's not about magic, it's about show business in general, and concerts and shows and all that. It's called IQ. And there was an article by the manager of Billie Eilish. The article was okay. I don't remember anything from the article. But the title of the article, for me, was an epiphany. The title of the article were just three words, and they changed my life. Because it's when I read that title, everything became clear to me. The title was Sink or Swim. And I realized that is the only thing I need to choose. I have to choose. There's nothing else for me to choose. I cannot ask questions, I cannot complain, or I can ask questions which will not get answered, I can complain, will lead me nowhere. So what can I do in this situation? Do I want to sink or do I want to swim? Well, no one using his brain is going to say, oh yeah, great, I'm gonna choose sink. So I chose swim, okay? But by choosing swim, I was perfectly aware of what that meant to me. Swimming, the decision of swimming, means that I don't get to know how cold or hot is the water. I don't get to know what is the distance I'm going to swim for, or the amount of time I'm going to swim. I don't know if there are sharks or it's a very low sea. I don't know anything. So there's only two options. You either sink or you swim. Till when? We don't know. I'm still swimming. I might die tomorrow, because I will swim till my strength goes away. But on the act of swimming, and on that state of mind of deciding that my attitude would be to swim, suddenly many things, the status quo changed. So I decide to look to me and look to my team and my surroundings, and I propose a challenge to my team. We were all at home in telework, remote working. I don't know how you say it in English. In Portuguese, it's teletrabalho, telework, whatever.
Yeah, telework, yeah, yeah.
Okay, which I don't really know what it means in my area, working in teletrabalho.
Yes.
For a production company, no, I'm not familiar with the thing, but anyway, we were in teletrabalho. And there was one day where I sent an email to the entire team saying, okay, in 2 days, we are going to meet here at the studio outside in the garden. We all separate 5 meters from each other, all of that. But I would like you, before that meeting, you have 24 hours to send me by email stupid ideas. And the stupid ideas are on the following premises and the following conditions. Imagine that we are going to be in lockdown for 2 years. How do we survive? And this was my question. The reason why I said 2 years is not because I looked into the crystal ball and I found out this is going to last at least 2 years, like reality is proving. No, I was not that clever. The reason why I said 2 years is that whenever we have a problem that can be solved in half an hour or a week or two, we don't really fix the problem. We just wait the time to goes by and say, oh, okay, yeah, in two weeks, this is over. And then you get distracted, and then before you notice, the problem is gone. So if you want to solve a problem, but you honestly want to find solutions that are not obvious, the first thing we need to do is consider that problem is going to last forever. And therefore, the solutions you might find to fight the problem, to solve the problem, end up being more out of the box, because this was May last year, and if I would have said 6 months, maybe one of the solutions would be, oh, let's prepare something special for Christmas when everything is over. No, let's imagine 2 years. So it's two summers, two Christmas, two Easters, two everything. So we cannot find the solution close. We need to think about, for 2 years, we cannot do anything of what we have been doing during our lives.
Actually, you are the first one who said this, having this time frame, because I remember talking with a lot of magicians, professionals, as well as amateurs, who were hoping that maybe something around Christmas would work or not last year.
And possibility.
Yeah. Yeah, and we started, I mean, we are now more than 1 year already here with our YouTube live stream. As I also thought, okay, there's no chance for me to go to conventions anymore where I'm in contact with friends, fans, customers, etc. But I wanted to stay in touch with them and talk about what I would always do if I'm hanging out with them at a convention around the world. And that's why we started the YouTube stream. Now you have this great Studio 33, and well, usually you would use it inside, having a great studio inside. Yeah. But what you did there, not many people, I think, saw this who don't know you or have not been from Portugal. What did you do exactly then as an idea? What was the What was the idea then?
So basically, I might even be able to pull a video or two here to show you. But basically, what we've done is we looked at the space. And we had crazy ideas. But on that week, I was also on the phone on Skype with Walter Rolfo from Italy.
Yeah.
And Walter was telling me that he was planning on buying the rights to build a drive-in facility in Italy. And I said, but I think we have everything that we could do it here. And Walter said, yeah, that's why I'm telling you about this idea.
Yeah, we did this here as well, right? I mean, there were a lot of shows performing in front of cars.
Yeah.
Sure, yes.
So then what I've done is we looked at it and we produced it like we always do. Anything we do, we always do it like it is the last thing we do in our lives. We want to put everything on. We want to do the best we can and all of that. And then the production quality start being very good. And the moment I realized that this was very serious, I decided to call to some friends from other areas, like rock stars and actors and DJs and famous, nationally famous comedians, and said, look, if you want, come and do it here, because we don't perform for a long time now. It has been 4 months without performing. We cannot hold it anymore. And that happened. So the result was every week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, we had me doing a show on one day, and then the other day we have a rock concert, and the other day we have a traditional music. And so the major stars of the country, they came to perform here. It was not a money venture, but no one was interested in the money. It was just, there was one of the actors and also singer that at the end of his show came to me crying, and he said, if the price of experience, what I've experienced here tonight, was being 4 months at home, it was worthwhile. Because the emotion was incredible. I mean, we think that, oh, performing four cars, only say that who either was never watching a show from the car or never did a show from the car. Because the energy, it's absolutely incredible. Absolutely incredible. And that was just the first reaction.
Yeah, I saw also a promo video about this, about the shows that you did. I think it's on your website, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's luisdematos.com, just for all the guys who want to see it. The cool thing is, the stage was specially made in front of your studio with an awesome screen where everybody had a great, great, great experience as if he would be very close, even if he had to be sitting in his car.
Exactly. Let me try to do something here, which will freak out your technicians, but
I give you full screen right now. Let's see what happens.
Tell them that everything is okay. Sure. But I will try to show something.
That's the music. I know it.
Okay. So I will.
Screen sharing is called, I think.
Yeah, that's it. So share screen, and I think this is it. It's gonna be black so far. Don't worry. Can you see it now?
No, I don't. Why doesn't? No, why? Oh, wait 1 second. Oh, one second. Oh, wow. Can you rewind one more time, because we see it now, but can you rewind, please? Thank you. There you go. We have to switch back to your camera. Give me 1 second. I hope the music will not kick up a copyright. Oh, it's still there. Let me see.
No.
Yeah, there we go. I hope we will not throw up a copyright problem with YouTube. Otherwise, we will be kicked out of the stream.
Hopefully not.
But it sounded good. It's an amazing event. Are you still doing it this year as well or not?
No, this year. The thing is that I have this problem, which is I like to do. I don't like to get bored, so we try to do different things. And so that same year, in September, we premiere a new concept. In September last year, we premiered this new concept of show in Spain, and then we did. In December, we did 5 weeks in Portugal, in three cities, Porto, Lisbon, and Coimbra. And the show was called Luís de Matos Conectados, which means in English, connected. And was the only show that I heard that is really and truthfully an hybrid show. And why was that? It's because the set on the theater was made of almost 40 hanging screens, and everybody buying a ticket to go to the show would also get links to offer to family and friends in Portugal and around the world. So when they were coming on Friday night to see me and the theater, their friends in Germany, in Spain, in north of Portugal, at home, sick with COVID, whatever, they would be on stage as well. And I would just walk to those screens and say, hi, good evening, what's your name? And the person would say, oh, I'm Antonio. Okay, great. Who are you with here tonight? Oh, I'm with my cousin that is, please stand up. Oh, you know, together.
Unbelievable.
Oh, you are in Amsterdam. Okay, great. Can you show me? Can you prove you are in Amsterdam? Yeah. Oh, great. Perfect. So I had 40 of these screens and I would talk directly to these people, and these people would interact with the people on stage as well. So there were moments in the show where the audience in the theater would talk with the audience at home and vice versa. And there was moments on the show where what happens on stage is decided by someone at home that is chosen by someone in the audience and vice versa. And this is something we premiered in September in Spain. And the concept was so fun for us that we decide to go deeper and deeper, and we end up doing it 5 weeks, three in Lisbon, one in Coimbra, and one in Porto. And then again, we moved on. And that's why since May, we are doing something completely different again. We are doing another show called Luís de Matos Backstage, and that's how we continue to swim.
And I have to say that was very calm water. I was allowed to swim with you for a while because you invited me to be an audience member, and I so much enjoyed the show, and I can only recommend it to everybody to also do it. And if you want to see this, please check the, that doesn't work, the keynote, I got it. I wanted to have a kind of an add-on, and it doesn't work on this screen. It doesn't matter. No, don't do it. It doesn't matter. Go down into the description of this stream, and you will find the link to book one of the tickets. You would have to book it because this is a complete, and yeah, I can only highly recommend it. So it's down in the descriptions to get your ticket. And well, right now there are only tickets available for Portuguese language, right?
Yes. So what we have done is when we start the show, we took the decision. We took many decisions. One of them is that we would do it till the end of the year, in a way, because we honestly believe that things will not get back to normal till next year. It's not being pessimist. In my case, I
realistic.
Believe being realistic. Yeah. Also, if tomorrow everything goes back to normal, I don't need a warning 2 days before. I just need to wake up and go back to my normal life. It's not like, oh, please let me know when this goes to normal because we need to get ready to go back to normal. No, we don't need a warning. So even if I am being pessimist and I'm saying the end of the year, if the world goes back to normal in September, I'll be ready for that. I don't need pre-warning. So there are many things. I think that the magic world was fantastic in reacting to the pandemic. And the magicians were definitely, there's a good thing, in my case, I believe that there is a very good thing about how the magic world behaved when it comes to reacting to pandemic, and a very bad thing. Okay, so the good thing is that magicians were among the first that immediately adapt to do Zoom shows, to do live streaming and charging money for that. That was fantastic. I mean, the speed was fantastic.
However, I got the feedback. I got the feedback when I was at the virtual convention of the 4F guys, that they offered these Zoom shows, but the booking went down over the time. So I think the biggest problem mistake they did was that they just tried to move their show into an online medium without using their benefits and their features. Because if you are, and you did it so well that you are, and I think at the beginning I hated having Zoom shows, being not in a theater, etc. And I was only thinking, no, I don't want to see a conference anymore. I don't want to see another lecture. I don't want to see another show with Zoom. However, when you think about it and you really embrace it, and then think of outside of a box, what can you do with this medium? Because now you have the interact. It's not like a TV show where you are one performer with a million people, but you are performing like on a TV, but with an interaction right now with a spectator that you bring on to stage by just addressing one guy on the other end of the screen.
Yeah.
And you have the full control over the camera, what means you have a totally different approach than doing, the camera magic of Shen Lim, but interactive. Mm-hmm. And this should be a new category for, let's say, FISM, for the World Championship, because this kind of magic never existed before. But it's so important that we embrace it and develop it further, because I think even after the pandemic, there is a market to this.
I think so. I think magicians got lazy in general, because having been among the first of adapting to the new media, then they said, hey, this is great. I can do the exact same tricks I've been doing all my life. I just need to open my computer. I sit in my bed next to my pillow, and I do 45 minutes of magic, and I get 300 euros. It's fantastic. And this means that the most part of virtual magic shows are the ones that destroy the market because they were just bad. Now, yeah. I saw amazing online shows. I remember seeing Dan White, amazing online show. I saw Axel Eklau, great online show, because they have done it understanding the media and working in order to succeed there, and being very honest in commitment. So I believe that nowadays, like you, most part of spectators, when they hear about, oh, what, a Zoom show? No, I don't want to be looking at the computer after being all day working. If I want to see TV, I can see HBO or Netflix. So my take on this was, we need to do something that could never be done anywhere else except on Zoom. And now you start understanding the media, because the medium transforms the message. So you need to adapt the message to that media. What I believe is that when I do the backstage show, I'm not doing it because I cannot do it on the theater. I am doing it because this online possibility opens to me the door of showing the studio, of doing tricks in the workshop or in the secrets room or in the library, in the studio, of course, or in my office. So it's not that if tomorrow I can go back to the theater and do a live show, that will be different. But the audience that will come to see me at a live show, they will see at the backstage the same level of commitment and the same level of passion. And because, again, we do it like it is the last thing we'll do in our lives. So we do it as best as we can, and we put ourselves in the other side and say, what would be a nice experience? What would be a unique experience? What would be a pleasant experience? And yes, it's very pleasant. It's something, the magic does not happen on my hands or on my stage, but happens on your hands at home. It's a different experience if I send you popcorns that you are eating while you are seeing the magic show. It's a better experience if you have a little bracelet with numbers and I can, instead of picking a spectator, I say, who is number 501349? And, oh, it's me. Where are you? Oh, I'm in Tokyo. Okay, great. What time is now in Tokyo? Show me Tokyo from the window of your home. And all of this makes it exciting, at least for us. And in order to make a show exciting for everyone, in my opinion, it must be exciting for us to start with, because that's what you then convey, communicate, invade, and it becomes that enthusiasm becomes contagious. And I never seen this show. I have done it many times, but you have seen this show. Did you have fun?
And I have to say, you start an hour before the show, you start already streaming and you invite us to be already there to accommodate. And I even have to say, I left the screen and dressed up because you wanted the camera to be open. And I didn't want to have my shabby t-shirt from my work. And so, and we opened wine. I had the popcorn like all the others as well, and enjoyed a great show. And the nice part was everybody was there. I saw Richard Wiseman. I saw someone from Las Vegas. Can we name him? Or
of course,
not?
Yeah.
I don't know. Sure, yeah. David Copperfield was there in the audience as well. And we had Marco Tempest, Gaten Bloom, etc. Everybody was watching and enjoying this show so much. And it was really, I can only highly recommend that you would, please, can you add English dates very soon to the webpage?
So I tell you the thing. Once we realize that we could be watched anywhere in the world, we said, okay, I speak Portuguese, kind of. I speak Spanish, kind of. I speak English, kind of. Okay, let's do it in three languages. So I already have done shows in Portuguese, in Spanish, and in English, and all of them with simultaneous translation to sign
language
as well. And we will add more dates in Spanish and English till for the months from now till the end of December, because it's fascinating. I mean, it's fascinating that that night that you were with us, we had people in Australia. Raymond Crowe was watching from Australia.
Yeah, he was watching as well. Yeah, I forgot.
Japan, everyone. And suddenly a car vanishes at the studio and appears in between the hands of a couple in Canada. And all of this, it's I like to stretch the concept, and everybody's feels that we are connected and together. The idea of putting, of starting the stream 1 hour before, along with another one I will tell you, it's directly taken from the live experiences. I don't want to say, oh, show is at 9, I sit and I turn on, am I doing something wrong? Oh, I want to put it sync with the TV, but I don't know how to do it. So 1 hour before, we start streaming with a countdown, of a rigorous countdown of 1 hour, so people can decide to connect to the smart TV. They can, like you, go get wine, open the popcorns, dress up, be there. And the other thing that I hated when I watch Zoom shows is that the magician would go, okay, thank you, and good night.
Yes, yes, I remember that.
And I go, what? What? So, because at the end of the show is that feeling of still being together and smiling and reacting and chatting. And it's like when a show finishes, we don't teletransport us home and it's over. There is a way of getting out of that high state, which is watching a show. So that's why the experience is long, and we even do the Q&A and all of that. So yeah, at the end of the day, between a 2 hour show, it's almost 2 hours, and a 20 minute Q&A and the hour before, it's a full evening.
Yeah. Well, you were also using, like me at the beginning, I should go back to this. You are using Slido as a communication platform so that you can answer questions, doing a Q&A, and that people can still be in the chat and talk about what they just witnessed and everything. It was really a very, very nice, it was an awesome evening.
Thank you. I enjoyed it
so much. I can only highly recommend. So whenever I will know from you that new English dates are available, I will announce it here in the YouTube stream for all the guys watching us, so that in the future you will they will not miss the moment where they can book one of the shows. Okay?
Thank you very much. That's very kind.
Sure, sure. That's my pleasure. Before that, I have something else on my question list here. I wanted to talk, but we are already, we have 12 minutes left. I would like to talk about the Essential Magic Collection, not the convention, but the collection that you started. And maybe for some it will be known, for others not. It's a collection of DVDs with the greatest artists from around the world. When did you start with all this?
Well, I started in 2009. And the reason why I started it, the biggest motivation, it's earlier than that, because I was very close friends with Tommy Wonder. And what I felt when Tommy Wonder left us is that it's so unfair that some people leave this world without being properly documented, without passing along their genius and their creations and their philosophy and their way of seeing the world. And when they die, everything goes to trash. And this is something that only came to my mind when Tommy passed away. We were really close. And I said, I could have done something. I work on TV. We could have done something. I should have. And that's when I decided to do something about it. So I said, okay, I'm going to invite the people that I admire the most, and maybe some of them I will be able to convince to properly explain not just tricks and techniques, but also to allow us to know more about their personality, their life, why they are what they are. And it's incredible. It's incredible so far. The Essential Magic Collection prevented the world from losing René Lavan heritage, Or, for example, Paul Daniels explained...
Paul Daniels, exactly.
He explained things that he never explained in his life anywhere. So thanks to the fact that he was kind and generous enough to accept my challenge of doing this series of DVDs, now the magic world, it's not so poor as it would be with the loss of Paul Daniels without us being able to have 8 hours in his company. And it's very honest. I mean, all the artists from Fringe John to David Williamson, all of them are very, very open and honest. Because on these DVDs, I always take them to perform for real people in a fantastic place. Like René Lavan in the Palace of the King, Lennart Green in the University of Coimbra, all of these iconic places where I believe, as a performer, they would like to be remembered. Not in a garage somewhere or at the Ruskin at 3 o'clock in the morning. No, no. They are being recorded, doing what they are good at the most dignifying place. And that's something for us to remember them at their best. Also, then we come to the studio. They explain all the tricks, techniques they have done publicly. And then we started this trend, which has been used by some DVD producers as a way to fill time when they say, oh, we only have 10 minutes of material. Let's make an interview and say it's a 2-hour DVD. Many have done it. We don't do it for that reason. We record 4 to 5 hours of conversation and we use 4 segments of 20 minutes. So just because I believe that when we are talking to someone that first I admire, that's why I invite them. Otherwise, I don't invite them. I'm for spending an entire week with someone I admire. Lots of stories come up during lunch and dinner. Stories, points of view, ideas, states of mind that have no other place to be documented because you don't share that on a lecture, on a magic convention. You
absolutely
don't share
not.
That during a show. You don't share that when you go to have a drink at the end of a convention. You don't put it on a book. So this became the perfect place. And yes, many of these stars can be seen crying during those interviews or laughing during those interviews because we are getting a little piece of what goes in their hearts and their brains. And I think we become all more rich that is recorded somewhere.
Yeah, I can fully subscribe to this. I myself have to say, for instance, I'm so lucky that I would be allowed to be part of the 4F convention, the Factors Finger Flicking Frolics, where all the guys are high-level magicians, and there's not like a fan base or another convention where you are not able to hang out with your heroes whatsoever, and you have... I mean, the gathering and spending time with each other is just the most beautiful and precious gift you can get within a year.
Absolutely.
So if it's on your DVDs, I can highly recommend to look into those. And actually, we have a very great offer thanks to you. If you go down in the description, you will find the link to the... to the EssentialMagicCollection.com website. And if you are using the code CARD-SHARK, it's all in the description down there, you would get a 30% discount on every DVD you want to watch. How cool is that? So mm-hmm. Thank you very much for this generous offer.
Definitely. You know that I am your friend and I am your fan. And I am very grateful for everything that you brought to magic and will continue bringing to magic. I think card shark, there is card magic before card shark and after card shark. And that is fantastic. That is fantastic. It never happened before that we could talk to someone that can make it happen, that can build it, that can market it, that can get us a special thing. I mean, who's Christian at the bicycle? Who's Christian at Cartamundi? There's no Christian at these major corporations. And here we have what is already a major corporation like Card Shark, and the owner talks to us, and we can talk to him about doing special projects like what we have done for like the magic deck we worked on some years ago for the illusionist, which literally is what I consider the best door ever existed to magic. And we both created this product for a special occasion, but with that intention. And it's absolutely fantastic. Some magicians went crazy that we did such a good product for lay audience. But that's the only way. It's to respect the others that knock. We need to respect everyone that knocks at the door of magic. Because it's because we are very secretive that magic does not develop. Picture this. Magic is the oldest performing art. There are records that say magic was performed 2,500 years before Christ. So if we make the counts, it's almost 5 millennia. It's almost 5,000 years. But a few years ago, a few decades ago, there was a magician who invented cinema. His name was George Méliès. Now, if you would like to do a graph that reflects the evolution of magic throughout 5,000 years, or the evolution of cinema in a few decades, it's a line that is almost parallel to the bottom of the graph for magic, 5,000 years. It didn't came up very high. It's still there a little bit. And cinema, a few decades, immediately goes up.
Yeah.
The reason being that the sharing of the knowledge makes the development. So anyone, thanks to the sharing of the secrets and of the knowledge, can nowadays be a great director or a movie enthusiast or so many other things in the movie industry. Magic, no. We close ourselves, which not only generates a lot of inbreeding because there is not fresh blood coming in, because we need to protect the secrets. We cannot tell them. Oh, because if we give the secret away, we lose our power. And we are very powerful. We cannot give the secret. Well, a guy that plays the piano, he doesn't mind giving away the secret of how a piano works or how he interprets the Fifth Symphony of Beethoven, which means that other people are welcome into this world and they can bring new blood, new energy, new creativity. And that's not happening in magic. And some of the new blood, because the history of magic is not widely spread, I'm sure that somewhere in the world there is a kid today that invented the double lift. And he thinks he's the best.
And he does a YouTube video about it, yes.
And this means that magicians are constantly reinventing the wheel, when we should already have invented the motor and everything that comes after the wheel, but we keep inventing the wheel. So anyway, the magic deck was clearly a result of your love, knowledge and competence, and my love for magic and ambition. So this product, which was sold during the European tour of the Illusionist tour, was the most expensive item on the gift shop, but was the one that sell the most.
It was the best seller, right? And it was promoted by a non-magician who learned it and turned into a magician afterwards, right? He was great, doing great. I saw him.
Yeah, exactly. And so what have we done? What magicians would have, I mean, normally a tour like this would have produced a Svengali deck and just put it in the market and sell it at the end with the magician signing. Well, the Svengali part is just one of the three major principles that are contained in this magic box. This magic box includes a four-hour tutorial. This magic box includes 50 tricks, and this magic box is good for the kid that goes tonight when he arrives home. He can do immediately five tricks. But if he really falls in love with this, he can dedicate the next 6 months of his life, and he will still not have mastered some of the illusions that you can do with this deck of cards.
And I fully agree with you. And I think the principle we built into the deck were really cool. And well, we are still planning on releasing this one outside of the Illusionist's tour.
Yeah, yeah.
So you already prepared everything so that the video material, etc., was already filmed.
Yeah.
And now we only have to get back onto track and release this, right?
Yeah. I wish I would have one of these when I was young. Without saying too much, but even the Tamariz mnemonic is within this little box. So that's how deep this product is. I mean, my best consultants worked with us on this. Paulino Gil from Spain, David Ridland from England. We gather every piece of material from Ask Alexander, Bill Kalush, till what is in the market today. And we made a very serious, special door for people that loves magic. It's three levels, and you will not get bored. I mean, anyone, this is a great door for people to come in. And we even share bibliography and other sources to learn. I mean, it's fantastic.
Yeah, what I liked about this, the approach that you had when we got together was that you didn't just want to have a magic box that a grandmother would buy for his child at a show whatsoever, with cheap Chinese whatsoever gimmicks, etc., that you can play one time and then throw it away. Right. This was not exactly the approach. You wanted to have the best entry into the magic world that would go deep or stay very, very at the surface. If you don't want to dig deeper, you would be fine there as well. But if you want to, it would be like going into a rabbit hole of magic and starting there. What was a great, great, great idea. I think that was awesome.
My dream is that I will live enough to one day listen to an interview of some future famous magician that will say that, when did you start in magic? I started magic because I bought the magic deck.
I'm 100% sure it will happen. I'm 100% sure it will happen. We just have to get older a little bit and release it. I mean, certainly we have to.
Yeah, but there's no rush.
Yeah. Well, actually, I'm looking at the clock, and we already are online here for an hour, and it feels like just half an hour or so. So much fun talking with you.
That's how we arrive to the end of the first episode of a series of 52 streams.
Okay, deal. I'm happy to have you back on here on this YouTube stream, definitely one more time, and going for other topics, because I only had two of the topics that I had on my list, and I would have loved to talk about those as well, but everything else was so interesting. Thanks so much. I got a very interesting an idea of someone in the chat who saw who said you should please consider learning German, so that this show could only also be in another language.
I already started that. I already know how to say Krankenwagen.
What? A Krankenwagen? Yeah. I remember that.
I'm going for my second word, which is Krankenhaus.
Okay, that works. I'll give you some other tips later on. What else would be very similar to your language anyhow. Hey, it was awesome talking with you and seeing you again after being away for such a long time. Thank you for sharing your time with us. And until then, talk to you soon very much. Bye-bye. Ciao.
Soon. Thanks, Christian. Thanks to all your technical team and thanks to everyone that have watched our conversation live or recorded, and see you all around soon, hopefully. Thank you.
We will. Other than that, you have already a great approach with the Zoom show, and well, I think Portugal is not so far away. I really want to come over to your place as well.
You're
talk to you soon. Until then, bye-bye.